discuss about some additional features which are available in Blue Prism. Okay, so let's get started. So in this additional features, we will see what is the objective, and there are something called a collection action. Okay, so choice stage, how we do a logging, and then how we can view them, and then what is export and import with respect to Blue Prism. Okay, this will cover in this video. So collection action. So before going to this, actually the objective is we need to there are some additional features in Blue Prism, right, which we need to learn about them, so which will enhance our performance, and then it will be very easy for us to deal with any problem solution. Okay, so what is the collection action? So we have seen different stages in Blue Prism, and then with few we have not covered, right? That is intentional. And then so we will take a specific use case for this, and then we will go through what is a collection and then how it is very useful, right? So when it is coming to a collection, so it is by default it is available in as a business object, right? Hope you know what is a business object by now, right? And then there are already some operations or functions which are readily available, actually, right? So something like what is add row, remove row, count rows, count columns, remove all rows, copy rows. So these are some default functions which the Blue Prism is giving us. If you are in a situation where you want to add more, you can add some code stage and you can do it, right? Or you can import external VBOs, right, which will enhance or have additional features additionally to this, right? So let's go back to the studio and then see how we can pull a collection, and then what we can do, how we can play with this collection action, right? Let's go back to the tool actually now. So I will create a new object just to explore this collection object sample. Okay, sample. So I have created a specific object for this. So if you see here, so there is something called collection here, okay, on the left. So when you pull here, so this is a data item, right? So this is a data item. So when we have some collection, so I will keep some quickly some fields actually, or I will try to use the collection which is already there in other process or something. So I will take a queue process. If you see here, student details is one collection, right? I will use the same collection, and then I'll copy paste here in the interest of time. So we have got the same collection here, right? We can do a copy paste, and this is how it is there, right? See here, yes, we have the data ready, and then we can continue from here. So we will pull that action which we are talking about. So I have pulled one action, okay, this is one action, and in this action, if you see, these are the objects which we have created: bank statement, browser Google, some collection of its sample, Excel reading, these all are there. This MS Excel VBO, queue object, utility, these are pulled from external VBOs. Means these are not by default available in Blue Prism. So this has to be pulled or imported. So we will go with the export import features later on, but for now, so just understand these are external VBOs, right? Internal. So Blue Prism by default gives this objects actually, right? Out of which we'll be using collections. So if you see here, there are multiple functions here. So add row, copy row, count columns, count rows, something like this. So we'll use some count rows actually for now. If you see here, collection. So what is that is, we will give this student collection, and then if you see the specific error, the problem is we normally drag the variables into the placeholder, right? So when we drag here, it is, what it is saying is the required data type is text, but the data type of student details which we pulled is a collection. The problem it is saying is when we said like this, student details is a collection here. So it is expecting a data type of collection name of type text actually. I think you got the problem, right? So this has to be given in double quotes. That's it. So you have to learn this and then understand this, that based on data, if it is a database collection here, you can drag and drop the student details directly. Okay. So what is the output? Output is count, means count rows, right? So to understand, if you click on this icon, it will just create a variable count. No, but I will say count rows and then I will click on the icon. So what will happen? A number variable of count rows is given. So this is for more readability perspective, and then I will give the action name also count rows, right? So I will close this. And similarly, if we want count columns, so I will copy paste the action, and then what I will do is I will say count columns. So student details, the column collection is same, and the output is not count rows. I will make it as count columns actually. Okay, count columns is the action name, and then I am creating a new variable. Okay, so these are the two. Let's quickly see how it, so let me quickly link them and then see how it runs. Right, this is how it is being done, and then let us see if we run this, how we can do it. I am saving. And now let us run this. So it is reading this, so I think this has to be somewhat big. The value came, but because of size we are not able to see it. So let me refresh this and rerun. So if you see here, count, there are 6 rows and then 4 columns. Right, this kind of collection actions or the actions here which can be used here. So remove all rows will remove the complete rows. So we will use remove row, only one row, okay, and then we will see how it works. So let me remove this, the last one. So after we do it, so if this is the thing, and then the action name which I'll be keeping is remove row. Make sure you are not calling remove all rows. That is, if you are very particular and very keen about it, keen about the function, do it. Means it will remove the complete rows here. So output is nothing because it is just removing the one row from the entire collection. Okay. So I am saving this, and after it I will see. So I can use the same action again here, so that it will tell me after removing the row how many rows are available. So you can see here also the collection is showing by default 1 out of 6, right? That also you can see how it is getting updated. Okay, so let's see how it is doing. So these are self-explanatory, but still why we are doing it here is like you will understand in a much better way. So count rows 6 are there, 4 are there, got removed, and then count rows is again 5 now, right? So now you see here it has been updated. If you see here the values, so the values, the row is, one row is removed. So this is before we have created, and this is initial in the sense before the process got executed. There are 6 actually. Once the process is executed, there are not 6, only 5. And if you see here, what is the difference is the first row which is there, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you see here, that gets removed every time. By default, when you are trying to read a collection also, example, I don't iterate through a loop and then I will say get the value of the first one or second one. So I will use some calculation and I will see what is the value I am getting from the first value. What is the row actually, without looping it, I will be seeing the first row actually. That is how it is designed. Okay. So let me see this. So I will say collection student details, I want ID, okay, and that I want to store it in a different variable name called student ID, right? Let me create the student ID and then get ID is the calculation stage name. So I will without actually looping it. Normally we have seen to loop and then do it, but without looping, whether we will be getting data or not, we will be seeing. Yes, we will be getting it, and by default it will be the first one, right? That's what I am saying. So similarly, remove row will remove the first row, right? So this is what you need to understand. So let me just make it big so that it will be easy for you. So I am saving it. If you see, again we have 6, so I am not, after doing this, after removing a row, I need to reassign the count or reassign the collection to the main collection, initial collection, then only it will be getting affected. So now I am, what I am doing is, count rows are 6, columns are 4, remove, got removed, 5, has no current row. I think it got removed, so it is, one second, as it, we will remove this and then we will see how it is getting. I will remove this as well because this doesn't make any sense now. So let's run this. Save. You got the ID? So this is how it has the first row can be pulled by default. Similarly, remove also have done it. But what we can do is, what I will do is, I will add one more action, remove row, and then you will see how it gets impacted or how it is really reflecting here. Okay? So collections, remove row by default it will pull the first row, which I am saying. So the same error again, so we have to give it in. So don't get panicked by seeing the error. If you read the error, it clearly says what it is there. Okay, and then these are the inputs we are doing. So let us, right, and then if you do through a loop and then removing the rows, it will be working. So this, what I will do is, I will give the name as remove row, okay, and then we will see how it is really making a change now. Save. Let me run now. Right? But if you see here, but if you go to the collection and see the current values, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 will not be there, but the initial value has this. So it is able to remove it. Right? We can similarly, we can add row also. Add row is nothing but we want to add a row and we want to add a data. When you say add row, if you see here, it is just asking what is the collection name, and then there is no output. But you will be feeling that we have added a row, but what is the value it is taking? So once you add a row like this, you need to, so let me give an example for you. So add row, when I say add row, it just adds one blank row to it, right? What you can do is, similar to get ID, I can do a collection and then I will add the values to it. Let's see. So this is our student ID, right? So what I will do is, I want to store it in the column. So this is the ID I want to give, 1, 2, 3, 5, 1. So this is the ID I want to give it and store it in student details dot ID column. Okay, so we are setting an ID. Similarly, we can set more values. Like if you see the collection, it has ID, gender and many things. So let us quickly set. So I think you know, right, collection will do only one thing. We'll use a multi-calc. Okay, set row data, right? So this is how we want to do, and then so I will see what I will be giving. So student ID, I want to store what? I want to store in, what is that? So 1, 2, 3, 5, 1 is what I want to store. right? I want to add four columns similar to this, and then what is the gender? Gender I want to give is male, and then location. So I want to give the location as, so it's a string, right? So I am giving in this thing, so it is location 5, and then name. Name I also, it's a string, I want to give as name 9 or something, right? So this is how I want to give it. So this is the multiple expression. This is also one additional feature which you can see. So this is what we are doing, and then after add a row, I want to set this, and then I will see how it runs now. Let's see how it runs now. Okay, so getTrade is giving this thing. I'm adding a row and then setting the data for the empty row. So add row will create an just an empty space, and then set row is setting that values into the empty space, right? That's how you have to understand. So let's run this. So rows are 6, columns are 4. Get it if you have got something, add row, set data and closed. So if you see here, there are 7 rows in the collection. So let's see how it is. So initial data will have only 6, but the current values are, if you see here, this is the one which we have added latestly, right? So this is how we can play with the collections and do what we want, right? And then now we will go ahead with the next additional feature. Still think purposefully, because during that use case we did not had any this kind of need actually. What is a choice stage? So think that if it is a simple if else condition, we used a stage called decision. Yes, decision is something related to if and else condition or true or false condition. But you have some expression or you have some condition where you need to take the different route, right? Means there are multiple processes are there, and based on a condition you need to select the process. Example, a person is coming to you, and then based on the example he says, I want to go to 5th class. So you will say go in this route. The person says I want to go to 1st class. He will say, you can say go to this route. So choice is something like, it's a similar to switch case in normal logical flow, where switch case means based on the input, the particular case is being identified and then that is got executed, right? So we will quickly jump into that specific use case, and then we will see how the tool is enabling us to deal with such kind of issues. Let's go back to the tool now. So we will say choice sample. Choice sample. Okay. So let me open this. So I need to go to action one. You can rename also, but okay, some sample. So we want to use this. If you see here, where is the choice? This is the choice. If you see here, decision is like a diamond, right? So similarly, if you see here, there are multiple set of diamonds are there. Means there are set of, it's a multiple decision box are there. That's it. So calculation is single. Multiple calculations can be done in the single stage. It's as simple as that. So if you see here, by default it is showing only the starting and ending. So one more you have to remember is, choice also comes with a tail. You have seen weight comes with a tail, right? Loops comes with a tail, and then here choice also comes with a tail. So rest all don't come with a tail, others are independent, right? So this is one important point you might need to store in your memory. So this is, so when you click on this choice, these are the conditions, how many conditions you added. Example, I am having 5 conditions here, I removed one, there are 4 conditions here. Once you close it, if you see here, as there are no variables or no values given here, it is not, you are not seeing anything here. So let me create some variables. Okay, let me create some variable, that will be better, and then we can do it. So what I want to do is, I will have a data item, and then I will say the data item value is some name, okay, and then name, and then it's a text, and then I have no value to it as of now, okay. And now let's do the choice thing. So if you see here, there is nothing is value given. So what is the choice name? What choice name is nothing but the name which you want to give actually for the thing. So it is a check A. So this is the name I means I am doing whether it is either it is A or B or not. So the second one is check B, check C, check D. This is the name of the condition, it's not the condition. Remember, this always results in true or false. If it is true, it will go inside the branch. If it is false, it will continue to the next step. That's it. Means when this expression is evaluated, what I'm doing to do is I have a text, right? What I'm doing is if name equal to A, then it will be satisfied and it will go into that specific branch. If it is B, it will satisfy this, and if it is C, this is D, right? This is what I'm saying, and then I will say, what is the choice actually? Check for names. This is the condition we have kept. If you close here, if you see here, there are four sub diamonds which are created. So everything is, if it is yes, you have to go to the next branch. Right. So what I'll do is if you see here, set name. So if it is A means, if it is the value is A means I want to set some name to that same text actually, name or something. Okay. So what I want to set is if it is wave is A for Anand. Okay. This is what I want to set. Okay. Next is B we need to have. Right. So for B, I will see if it is B means I will say B for what's the name we can say Bharat, okay. So C, for C I want to keep some name like Charan, right. So just see how simple it is. And D, for D what I want to have is Dharam. Right. So what I'm, if you see here, now I will do the linking. Means if the first condition is satisfied, which is A, right, it will go to this condition. If the second is satisfied, this stage, this stage, this stage. So I will just rearrange to make it beautiful. Okay. So I'm just rearranging so that it will be seen beautiful for us. Okay. So this is the next. This is the next. If you see here, what is the conditions are seen? What is the name I have kept is shown here. If you are able to see. Right. So let me increase the font size. So if you see here, this is what is happening. Right. So this is what is happening. Based on the condition, the name can be set, and if it is otherwise means it's a default thing. You can make it go to end, means you can go it to make it end. Otherwise you can, it is giving an error because there is no connection between these all. And then after set stage also, you can make it close to end, or you can go to some other process or other action, no issues. So that all depends on how we are doing it. So let me just anchor this and then, so I'm just doing the linking, because any process or flow should not be left without closing to the end. Means it's, you should not leave them in air. If I, there should be an output for the calculation and then it is coming to an end. If you see here, this is logically closed. So let me save this and then run. So before running, I have need to give a value to this, right? Let me give a value as B. So when I'm giving a value as B, saving it, and then when I'm running it, so the intention is the second condition means that the Intention is the second condition will be picked up, and then it has to set the name as what's the name we have set there, and they should close it, right? Let's see this. If you see here, it went to Bharat, and then the name is being set, and then it came here, right? If it is very fast, let me keep it in slow mode. So it came to check names, and then it will go to set name, which is B, and then name is changed as Bharat, and then went out actually, right? Similarly, I can make it the name as D or something, and then let me do a refresh and save, and then let me run this. So if you see here, set name is D is what selected. So I have given a simple condition, but you can give any expression which results in it, and then the particular branch will be picked up, right? So this is how we can use choice. So let's go back to the next topic. So the next one is export and import. Yes, this is very important. Okay, I think we missed this one. So this is logging in log viewer. So for any condition or any exceptions or any kind of thing, we want to see how the process has been executed and what are the values it has been done. And example, you will be keeping some if else condition, right? Means which process it has taken. And example, if you see the choice stage, there are four stages, four calculations where set name, which can be A for A, B, C, D, right? You don't know which one is being picked up. So if we are doing a logging, like, you will be understanding what are the process or what are the business objects which are being touched up, what is the flow in a process is being touched up, and then what is the end result. So logging is very important for us to do the monetary thing, and then if we want to see how the processing happened, right? This is very important for us. So this stage, so in properties of every stage, we can see something called this. If you go to the properties, if you see here, it is there, it says what is there, means we can select it is enabled or disabled. So by default, what happens is, if a stage is in process, by default it will be, the logging will be enabled. If a stage is not there in process, the staging is default not enabled, we have to enable it. Means if a stage is pulled into an object studio, what it means, the logging is defaultly not enabled, you have to enable it. If a stage is, same stage is pulled into process studio, the logs will be enabled, and you have to, no need for you to do any change. And if you want to stop the logging, you can make it disabled. Let's go there and see how we can. So if you open double like this, if you see here, the stage is defaultly disabled. This stage is disabled, means this is an object studio where we are using the choice, right? So let's see. If you see here, this is a start stage, and what is this? Logging is disabled, right? So this is the problem. And then otherwise, what we'll do is, I will close this and let me open a process studio. So we have this, and then let me open a action or any stage here. If you see here, the logs are enabled. So by default it is giving like this, and then you can change according to your need actually. So let us see how we can see the logs. In a control room earlier, if you see here, we have run some process, and then we have seen what it is there, right? So if by default it is today, it is there. When I'm saying all, this is the process which we have run earlier. So right, if you double click this, so these are the logs which you are seeing here. So these are the stages which, if you see here, these all are related to process studio only. Means the logs which are resulted to process studio only, not anything related to object studio. But if you enable the logs there, you will see the logs related to that object studio as well. So by this you will understand. See, if you see here, what is the calculation happening, what is the loop happening, what is the decision happening, what is the value, and what is the fifth loop or sixth loop. You can see, means what is the value which got assigned, right? So what is the location it got assigned. So we can understand like this how it is equally or how it is seamlessly going. We will clearly understand by seeing the logs how the process is being done or executed, and then how the values are being retrieved or generated. So it will be like this. So this is one advantage of So after Logwear, we need to know something about export and import. So this is one important feature where think that your colleague has built something interesting, a function which you want to utilize in your Blue Prism or in your within your process. So the normal thing what you do, example your colleague has done something and you want to use it, what you have to do, you will just copy paste the code into your local thing, or you will ask him to keep it in a shared drive and then you will refer to the shared drive. Similarly, export and import gives you a feature of packing up things, right? I means you can bundle it in, like you have a functionality which your friend has built it. You can bundle up those things. You can ask him to export it as an XML, and the same file can be imported. The same XML file can be imported into your Blue Prism, and then the action or the object will be seen to you. And then you can reuse it. And one more advantage of having this is, think that you are not having this SVN or any other versioning system where it is very means what you are doing, the changes might go away. And you are doing step by step, and you want to save phase wise or step wise changes. Example, what you work today, you want to save it. What you work tomorrow, you want to save it. So what you can do is to have a backup, right? You can package the complete things and then you can export, okay, and then save it as a file, right? So let's see how we can do this. So this is very important from backing up or from reusability standpoint. This is a collection sample which we have seen here. So this is one thing, that this is one function or a big object which you have built, and then you want your team to utilize this, right? So what we can do is, you can go to file, export, right? Export this. So this is a process, I think. So process or object, anything can be exported. Okay, let me say this destination. What is the destination file name? So this is a collection sample, right? And then I'm doing a finish. So let me create a new folder for you. So let me create a new folder. New data. So this is our folder for us, right? I want to export it to here. Okay, let me export it to here and then see how it will happen. So I will do export this process and collection sample and then browse. So browse is for giving that name. Just a second, it's taking time. So I want to give the path as given, and then this is the one I want to do it. So save. So this is where I want to save. Okay, finish. So once you say finish, if you go to the data, you will have this object sample. Now what I will do is, in our Blue Prism we have this object studio, and then we have this collection object sample, right? This is what we have created or we used. So what I will do is, I will delete this. So I will right click and I will say delete object. So reason is sample. So we have to give a reason why you are deleting it. Now if you see here, there is no object for us. Means think that this is your machine where it doesn't have that collection object sample functionality, right? You want to import now, right? Where you have this folder structure ready, right? So what I will do is, this is file import. What I need to browse for the file. So I will go back to the same folder where I have saved it, and then I will say open, and then next it is extracting, and then I will say finish. If you see here, you have got the same object, and then you can use the same way you have done earlier. So simple, right? So these are some additional features which will enhance your solution perspective, right? So hope you have understood. Keep watching. Keep learning.